Hi guys, welcome to the final episode of this season. And today we have the man who needs no introduction in the quizzing world, Major Chandrakant Nair. And this has been on top of my mind since forever. When was the last time someone called you Chandrakant?
I don't think even my mom, dad call me Chandrakant these days. So, I mean, it's been ages. So, if I'm walking on a road and somebody calls me Chandrakant, it's unlikely that I'll turn back and ask who this is.
Okay. Major, we'll jump right into the questions. So, sure. I'll take it away.
Yeah. So Major, could you tell some of the earliest quizzing memories that you have from school days or even from before that?
So basically what happened with me is my earliest quizzing memory would be from as early as third standard. So I'm from a place called Nilambur, which is about an hour and a half from Calicut. So Calicut in the news for the air crash. So the same Calicut. So what happened in the late 80s, early 90s, so my place is pretty close to the Western Ghats. So orchids are a very common phenomenon here. So there's hardly any light during winter months. So what happened was both my parents are doctors. So they had the luxury of us being in school during the daytime. So we are three brothers. So we are in school during daytime. So they don't really need to take care of us during daytime. But once they're back from the hospital after their daily work, three boys, I'm sure all of you would know how tough it is to manage three boys. So my dad and mom both were quizzers from their school and college days. So what my dad used to do, okay, three guys who are at the peak of their naughty stages in their life. So he had to keep us cool, calm somehow. So what he used to do, he would start asking us questions with a token prize of a toffee, chocolate, something like that. So this used to happen during the power cut period in the evening. So this would go on for about an hour and we would be waiting for these question sessions throughout the entire day. Okay, at 7 o'clock, the light will go. Then we can have our quiz session. We'll get toffee, we'll get chocolate. So that was my earliest introduction to quizzing. And that sort of hooked on. And then thereafter, we started getting these school quizzes. Initially inter-class quizzes and gradually it became inter-school quizzes and that is how it sort of took off from this. So that would be my earliest quizzing memory. Very, very fond memory, but yeah.
And how did it translate to college? Did you just, was there a gap in quizzing when you shifted?
Not really. I mean, so my quizzing journey from class third, so it's been more or less a continuous journey. So I've been quizzing since class third without any kind of interruption. Quizzed in school at the inter-school level, inter-district level, interstate level, national level in school. And thereafter, when I joined, so till class 10th, I was in Kerala. And 11th and 12th, I didn't from Delhi. So the school quizzing continued in Delhi as well. And after that, cleared my entrance exam and joined AFMC Pune. So Pune probably maybe at par with Delhi in terms of college quizzing. So the two bigger best cities in terms of the number of quizzes and the diversity of quizzes, in my opinion, would be Delhi and Pune. Purely because these two cities have the maximum number of colleges. So in Pune, just like Delhi, we used to have at least one or two quizzes per day. Maybe not to the levels of quizzes that you have in Delhi, but yeah, almost there. So thereafter, then I got my commission into the Indian Army. And had my field posting in Nagaland. So that was one time when I could not attend too many physical quizzes. So what I used to do, I would hop into Guwahati once in a while. And that is how I got in touch with all the good quizzes in Guwahati, Abradas, and a lot of quizzes there during my army days in the Northeast. Plus, that was the time when I think you guys must have been in school then. So that was the golden age of blog quizzing. Now it's migrated to Facebook and WhatsApp. So blogs were the in thing then. So you started my own blog then, and that ran for about 1,500 questions. So that blog then, I think it is still somewhere on the internet. So it was being managed by, I was doing it for an organization. So I think they migrated the blog from WordPress to their own website. and then a lot of material got lost there, but I think I might still have plenty of those questions. So thanks for reminding me of this, and once the episode is done, I'll try and find that link and share this. And after Nagaland, I came back to Kerala, and in Trivandrum. My posting was in Trivandrum, so it picked up again in Trivandrum, so could attend as many quizzes as I wanted in Trivandrum. So used to travel to Bangalore, Chennai, wherever possible. Even I think I traveled to Hyderabad and Delhi as well during my posting in Trivandrum. And then my commission, I was on a short service commission, and it came to an end in 2013. And that's when I realized, so the 3 years of lull with regards to physical quizzing in the Northeast, so I must do something about it. So I just thought, okay, let me just take 1 year off and then do only quizzing, and thereafter get back to something like whatever long-term career plans that I wanted. So then got into quizzing full-time, at least attending quizzes, and gradually, was setting a lot of, conducting a lot of quizzes also then, but then gradually a lot of people started asking me for quizzes, and then I gradually thought, okay, like, so this is what I always wanted. I always wanted to quiz, travel, attend quizzes, ask people questions. So whatever long-term career plans that I had, so it got postponed for one more year, and then one more year, and then one more year. And then reached a point where I think, why do it at all? I mean, this is what you always wanted to do, so why not just carry on with it? So that's it. That's how I reached this point.
All right. Major, you probably conducted more quizzes than you participated in the last 5 years, I guess. But if you had a choice between being a quiz master and being a prolific quizzer, what would you choose?
100% I'll pick the option of being a quizzer. I mean, I started off as a quizmaster. Quizzer. The quizmaster thing came in gradually. I mean, it was more like an accident. Always loved the concept of sitting and encountering a question to which you had absolutely no idea about, and then sit and brainstorm with your teammates and accidentally stumble upon the answer. I mean, without having any idea about what the question is all about, and then getting to the answer, I mean, it's a feeling that cannot be put to words. So for that one feeling, I definitely pick being a quizzer every single time over being a quiz master. I mean, the pleasure of seeing people do the same thing and crack your questions is also there. But on a purely selfish level, I would pick being a quizzer than being a quiz master.
It's also the easier thing to do.
Exactly. Right? I mean, it's not easy being a quiz master. I mean, so let's say there are two back-to-back quizzes coming up in Bangalore. So any random place. So the thing is, like, the kind of effort you need to put in to set that quiz, especially if this quiz has got a feature quizzers who've been quizzing for the past 15, 20 years. So you need to put that kind of effort. So just to avoid all that and just calmly go sit and enjoy answering questions.
So you are part of a quizzing team, as you said, CIDs of Kerala. So could you run us through the origins of and how the friendship with your teammates came into being teammates and things like that?
So the team name is actually CIDs from Kerala. So currently composed of Rishikesh Verma, Praveen VR, and myself. And former members include Jatin Jacob, Abdul Rauf, Raj Shekhar, and Josula Krishnamurthy for a brief while. So, I mean, we had a great time with all these people. So basically what happened is all of us are fans of Mohanlal. Mohanlal, in my opinion, a lot of people would contest this, but I would stand my ground and say he's the greatest ever actor on, Indian big screen. So we're all big fans of Mohanlal, and our earliest introduction to Mohanlal and his films where the CIDs trilogy. So CIDs trilogy, if you haven't watched it, so please go and watch the films on YouTube. They're all available on YouTube. So three absolutely hilarious comedy films. So basically, Mohanlal and Srinivasan, so they are two CIDs. They have accidentally become CIDs. They had no intention of becoming CIDs. They accidentally become CIDs. And so basically, it's like a slapstick humor and their misadventures while solving cases. So as a tribute to Mohanlal, our love for Mohanlal, and our childhood in general. So that is how the team name. So in the film series, they are CIDs from Tamil Nadu. So from Kerala, they go to Chennai and they get recruited by the Tamil Nadu police. They become CIDs from Tamil Nadu. So we thought, okay, let's be CRDs from Kerala. So that's how. And like you said, for me, quizzing is more about rather than just answering a question, rather than just sitting and meeting. More than that, it's like about meeting people and becoming friends with them. So my teammates, like, they probably are my closest friends, and we are friends first and then quizzes. So that team dynamic has always been there. I've known them from the time, even before we became teammates at the series from Kerala. So that's what quizzing is all for me. I mean, friendship is one primary reason why we quiz, and I'm thankful to quizzing for giving me so many good friends.
So we read in an interview that on some days you spend close to 16 hours on question making. That in itself is quite unimaginable to a lot of us. But how does your family react to this, given you are anyway away from your home for most of the year, basically?
So this probably, like, you could put in perspective with regards to the earlier question that you had. What would you prefer, being a quiz master or a quizzer? So the 16 hours thing is only because you need to set these back-to-back quizzes. So there's no other way. If you need to set a good quiz, and if there are two or three quizzes happening in a weekend, just not possible unless you sit and put 16 hours. And in my opinion, I am the laziest person I know. Given a choice, I would not want to do that. I would just want to chill, watch a film, listen to some good music, and have fun in general. But the 16 hours thing is primarily a consequence of having to do all these quizzes. So like last 4-5 years, I've been doing close to 90 to 100 quizzes. So there is no other way to set these quizzes. You have to put in that kind of effort, only then these quizzes are going to come out. And the thing is, like, you're not just setting a quiz for namesake. So people are taking their time out and coming to a quiz, attending a quiz. In fact, you should feel grateful to them. In my opinion, they are doing you a favor by leaving their work aside and coming to your quiz. So we might do our best to make it worthwhile. I mean, they should go back happy. They should feel that, yes, it was worth taking that time off and coming to this quiz. So that is why, that is where all those 16, 17 hours. So that is how I just want, whatever I do, I just want it to be, what do you say? I try to put in my best in this, which is why it's 16 to 17 hours. And coming back to your question, my family, like I told you, dad, mom, both have been quizzing since childhood. My brothers have quizzed in school. My wife, I met her through a quiz. So she was my childhood rival while we were in school. So she represented her school. I represented my school. And let me say this with a lot of pride. I hope she doesn't see this episode. She's never been able to beat me in a school quiz. I always put this right before her face. So all of them have been quizzers. All of them been quizzing for a very, very long time. So they know how much quizzing means to me. They know the kind of effort that goes into setting a quiz. They know the kind of effort that requires when one is traveling from, let's say, a place from like Kerala to Delhi to do a quiz. So they fully understand this, and they've always been extremely supportive, even if I don't get. So basically, during the peak quizzing season, I would meet Abhinav more number of times than I meet my own family. So that's how quizzing has been for the last 5-6 years for me. And my family fully understands this and they fully support this. So thanks, and really grateful to them for letting me pursue this.
Maya, this is a question that has come from my personal experience, because in every quiz of yours, I am eagerly waiting for the written round. I remember last year you put in, I think this was in Sarang, where the written round was based on last year's finalists' names or something like that. So where does the idea of these written rounds come from? Also, do you first arrive on a theme and then make the questions, or is it the other way around?
So basically, the quiz that you're talking about is the Lone Wolf quiz at SRM University. Okay. So this was their first ever Lone Wolf quiz, or their first ever quizzing festival for that matter. So when I went about setting this quiz, so I realized this is actually the first ever Lone Wolf quiz that I'm doing in my entire life. Until that point, I have done general quizzes, I've done sports quizzes, I've done disc quizzes, I've done cyclic quizzes, I've done Mela quizzes, but I had never ever done a Lone Wolf quiz till that point. So the thing was, like, so Chennai has this old Lone Wolf quiz called Sarang Lone Wolf quiz, collected at IIT Madras during their annual quiz. So I thought, okay, like how to go one better? Why, how to ensure that the people who come to this Lone Wolf quiz go back? Yes, this also should be on the calendar. So thought, okay, let me start the quiz with around on the Sarang Lone Wolf quiz itself. So I went back and found out who the finalists in that quiz was. And then what I did, so basically this round that you're talking about happened in the semifinals. So I think we had a total of 40 questions in the semifinals. So I try and incorporate a lot of cryptic stuff into the, not with regards to the framing of the question, but with regards to the placing of questions, with regards to a lot of things that if you look around on a slide, if you look around in the question, you may be able to cite more things. So what I did was picked the numbers from the Fibonacci sequence, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 21, 24. So basically Fibonacci sequences, the sum of every two previous numbers will give you the next number in the sequence. So question number one was a question on one of the finalists. In essence, it was not on them. So the finalists were Gokul, Pritam, then Sai Prashant, Rumaiza, Zainab, then Sukrut, Rishti, Sriram, Burgla. And yeah, so these were the finalists. So question number one was about the Ram Setu, the one that connects India and Sri Lanka. Question number two was about, it was about Amrita Pritam. Question number three was about Gokulam FC. Question number five was about the poet Rumi, Rumaiza's nicknamed Rumi. So like that, I put in questions as per the Fibonacci sequence, something, it's not a direct, doesn't what is it directly connect to the participant. It's just that some cryptic way it will connect to the participant. So Amrita Pritam, so Pritam, Gokulam FC, so Gokul, Ram Setu, so Sriram, Rumi, so Rumaiza. So put in the names of finalists as per the Fibonacci sequence. And the covering slide, the first slide where the thing appears like semi-finals, SRM University Lone Wolf quiz. So that was an actual image of Mr. Fibonacci, his statue in Pisa. And told people, okay, look at the slide carefully. This will guide you in your quest. And I had kept a concept of a wild card also in this quiz. So whoever figures out the theme, there's a hidden theme in this quiz. So whoever figures out the hidden theme in this quiz, even if they have not finished in the top eight in the semis, they will get a wild card slot into the finals. So somebody actually managed to crack the theme. I think only Lokesh Kaza, he managed to crack the theme and was the only one who made it to the finals in that manner. So basically the point is, try and all these written rounds, they've always been more or less of general nature. So whenever you start a quiz, the endeavor is that everyone likes answering questions. Nobody likes not answering questions. So start off with a nice, simple written round of questions should be of a general nature, but keep a theme like, let's say, rains. So there was this quiz happening in Chennai Kochi a couple of years back, the Illuminati quiz, which I've been doing for the last 10 years now. So that was during peak rainfall when Kerala was experiencing floods. So I thought, okay, it's raining, so why not form a written round on rains? So then we had questions on the green rain in Matrix. So we had questions on, rainfall in painting. So basically, you decide on a theme, that something that is relevant to the times, so it could be rains. So if it's a quiz happening in peak summer, then the round will be on heat. So like the last 5-6 months, we've been in the midst of a global pandemic. So done a couple of quizzes where the theme has been corona, that is crown. So I had about 6-7 questions on the concept of a crown, a metaphorical crown, crown TV. So the word, the sun's corona. So the kingdom of corona, where the plot of Dazzled is. So stuff like that.
Tangled.
So you basically decide on a theme only on the basis of something that is probably relevant, then it has enough material to give you 8 to 10 good questions of a general nature, not restricted to any particular topic. So, I mean, there are multiple factors that go into. The aim is that the question should be of slightly easier nature. People, they should not be really easy. They should not be FAQs, but they should be easy to work out. People should, at the end of the round, people should have at least have 30-40 points on the scoreboard and then move on. Aim is to gradually introduce them into the quiz proper. So that is how I decided on a written round theme and how to go about it. In fact, we even had a written round on Fibonacci sequence. The first question was about the number one. Second question was about number two. But then third about number three. So quirky themes where basically people, everyone, what I've seen in my life as a quizzer and quiz master, everyone likes stuff that that is slightly cryptic. But it's like you should approach it like a detective novel. There are clues provided. You try and figure out piece those clues together and then arrive at the answer. So that is what I've tried to do for these written rounds and in many of the cases in the quiz proper as well.
That reminded me of one of my favorites from your quiz, which was the first question will be an answer of one letter, the second would be of two letters, the third would be third letter, and so on.
I think Ragam, I think, NIT Calicut.
This was, no, I didn't attend in Calicut for sure.
You attended this, okay. Yeah. You have it on SlideShare, I think this, one of
which this. Must be one of the IIM Cold Code or the IIT Madras.
Probably.
It's been ages since I've uploaded. So I think I'll upload all these online quizzes because people have already seen them. There's no scope of reusing them. So thanks for reminding me with regard to that as well.
But Maya, if you have recordings of them, why not put them on YouTube? Because
I think the one that Abhinav took part is already on YouTube.
Yeah, that's
yeah.
Yeah, there's a quiz that I did for GyanSpace. So they will upload it sometime soon.
Okay.
And I think this can be made a nice, this can be put into motion. All these online quizzes can actually be recorded and people can put it up online. So that'll be a nice thing to do. I mean, you can actually try and suggest it to all the people who are doing online quizzes and get that. That should be a doable thing and should be fun. Yeah.
Okay. So do you have assigned guinea pig, sir? Or and who is it basically? Do you need a guinea pig or do you...
We're also asking if there are any openings available.
The thing with regards to having a guinea pig is you need the time to send the quiz to him. You need the time to go through it, figure out if there are mistakes, figure out if there are places where there should be improvement. So if somebody has to guinea pig a quiz, then that person will require at least to do it properly, at least a couple of days for sure. When you're in the middle of peak quizzing season, I mean, you hardly get any time to send it to anyone and get it guinea pig. But when I started off full-time as a quiz master way back in 2012, 2013, so I'm sure you know Hari Parameshwaran, who was in Delhi.
Yeah.
So Hari sir has been the best guinea pig I've encountered in my life. So I would send my sets to him and he would sit through and analyze every single question, every single word, every single punctuation mark, and tell me with such a beautiful detailed review he used to send me. And that ensured that at least in the initial phase of my life as a quiz master, like quizzes came out well thanks to the kind of effort he used to put in with regards to analyzing the quiz and telling me what is required, what is to be improved, how to put in more clues, if an image is required or not. So that kind of helps. I'm incredibly thankful to Hari sir for doing this. I mean, he is in the US now. I mean, he's no longer part of the offline Indian quizzing circle, but I would like to thank him for helping me out then. And so when they don't take part in the quiz, my teammates actually help and guinea pig. For example, a college quiz, so I always send it to Rishi and VR for guinea picking. I do it over WhatsApp or I run it live for them and see how their performance is. And then if at all time is available and if at all they are not taking part. So other than that, I've more or less not had enough time to get stuff guinea picked by anyone. I would definitely like to get stuff guinea picked by people. Just a paucity of time that has prevented me from getting it done on the kind of level I would want to. And a couple of other guinea pigs, like Arun Hiregangi of KQA. He also used to, once upon a time, he was a regular guinea pig. He used to go through quizzes and tell me in detail if whatever is required. And I am not sure if you know Krishna Akhil, who was at BITS Pilani, a very good friend of mine. So I met him while I was at BITS for their quiz, OSS in 2013. So In 2013, 2014, he has also guinea pigged a lot of quizzes for me. But after that, I really haven't had the time to get it done. But whenever possible, I always try and get it done. At least in the beginning of the season, I try and get it done.
So, yeah, I remembered.
Openings like Prithvi, opening, it's definitely open. But the thing is, there's just not enough time for me to, because I finished setting the quiz 1 or 2 days prior to the event. So there's hardly any time left.
That's one or two sure. days is a lot of time. For me, it's like 1 or 2 hours, basically.
A couple of weeks back, I was talking to someone and they told me, they asked me this exact same question. And just a casual conversation on Facebook. So he told me that my style of setting is very different from that of a college quizzer. So I asked him, so how does a college quizzer set? So the college, he said the college quizzer starts setting at 4 a.m. in the morning before the quiz and doesn't finish setting until it's about 1 hour after the time the quiz was supposed to start.
Yeah. 100%. So sometimes you would have somebody already starting the prelims and somebody is making the final quiz.
Yeah.
I did that last year for Cannot Place.
But yeah, I mean, these moments have their own charm. I mean, in my opinion, like they are what make quizzing what it is. So they should, nobody should try and change this setup. I mean, it should continue. It adds a lot of charm to a quiz. So but yeah, definitely you should try and finish setting different time, but if not, it's not an issue at all.
I think I would attest to the fact because the best quiz I have done was I had finished the quiz about 3 to 4 days before the hand, and I had sent Prithvi the quiz to GP, and he did it, and he gave me a couple of suggestions, and I worked with him a lot for the last 3-4 days.
It always helps.
So a
different set of eyes, a different brain would be able to see stuff that you yourself would have missed. They would be able to tell you, okay, so this may be slightly too tough, this may be slightly too easy. So remove this word, add this word, put in, a parenthesis there that would tell you this particular word is important, highlight this particular thing, add this particular image. So a fresh set of eyes, definitely recommended. And if time is available, all quizzes should be given. This is my suggestion.
Plus, sometimes you go into the question so much that you don't see the bigger picture.
Correct.
And somebody else comes in and they see that. And
yeah. That happens a lot with me because sometimes I'm reading a book and then there are 4 questions which are very much similar in context, and then someone has to tell me, no, these are all similar questions. Doesn't
exactly.
Even missed something that I had framed myself, which is something.
Which one?
So in the Buzz Aldrin, so his name came up because his sister couldn't speak his name, right?
Buzzer and Buzz.
You just framed it mildly differently from what I had about four months back in a DQC quiz, which is Prithvi's favorite quiz of mine. And I still missed it. I was like, yaar, kya, kyun main quizzing kar raha hoon?
The number of times I've missed a question that I myself have framed, I mean, at least... I have lost count of the number of times you frame a question. 1 week later, you're completely the same question comes. And so what happened was
in your instance, you frame so many that it's at least realistic and not for us. At least
in 2015, the QFI open quiz that I did in Chennai at IIT Madras. So there was a question on Tutankhamun's tomb, his casket. And the fact that it is lined with sequins. So that quiz, one of the finalists were the aardvarks. So they were the only people who traveled from Delhi and attended that quiz. Exactly 1 week later was Landmark Delhi. So I had traveled from Kerala to Delhi for that quiz. And that same question came in Landmark Delhi. Okay. Now the only other people in Landmark Delhi who had seen that question were the aardvarks. So my own question came up. They buzzed and got it. And I didn't.
Oh no. So did that have an effect on the result?
It did. They finished, I think we missed the podium. We finished fourth that year in Landmark Delhi. So aardvarks, I think, finished second that year. And that was scores were like 101, 98, 97, 96. So, I mean, just 1 or 2 points separating the top 2 or 3. So, but then quizzing is all about near misses and heartbreaks. So, Landmark quiz, we've been participating since time in memory, at least the last 10-12 years. So we've had multiple podiums at Landmarks, plenty of seconds, plenty of thirds, but we had, until 2018, we had never won it proper. The closest we had come to winning Landmark Quiz was in Bangalore, Landmark Quiz Bangalore 2018. We finished second by 1 point, just 1 point. So Dr. Arulmani and team won it with 174. We finished second with 173. But poetic justice, the very next quiz, Landmark Chennai 2018. So we won by 1 point. We had 154. QED had 153.
I remember watching those live streams and rooting for you.
Oh, it was streaming live then?
Yeah, on Landmark Facebook page.
Nice.
Oh. I think you shared this story, I think, somewhere on some social media. I remember reading.
That was a very, very memorable moment. And primarily because of the exact same, we lost it by 1 point. So we won by 1 point. So, and it made a hell lot of a difference. I mean, finishing second, I mean, there is nothing like winning. I mean, if you finish second and it's a quiz that you wanted to win for a very, 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 very long time. And you came that close and missed. So we were crestfallen that day. But then, the very next quiz.
If you finish by like 15-20 points, that's not
as much. Yeah, that's even better. 6-0 final, haar jao to theek hai. Penalties pe nahi aata.
What is the closest ever second or closest ever that you missed a win by?
I have to remember.
I have this memory. So we were trailing by we were fifth or something, and there were seven questions. And we answered six of them, consecutive answers. And we came 2 points behind the first, the team that was placed first. So if that day it was if there was only one more question in that quiz, we probably would have come first.
Oh, damn.
Yeah, because we were
actually 100 meter race mein start gandhi thi, lekin 110 meter toh pakad lete hai.
No, this also reminds me of a quiz in Bangalore. So KQA, they hold Persiflage. Persiflage is the annual book quiz that KQA hold every year. So at Persiflage, I think 2017. So as CIDs from Kerala, we won Persiflage in 2017. Myself, Rishi, VR, and Shyama. So we won it with a score of 462. Dr. Arulmani and three of his students finished second with 458. So the thing was, with four questions to go, Dr. Arul was trailing us by, I think, 44 points. So we didn't know that four questions were left at that point. We didn't know the number of questions left. Okay. So question, Arul answers, we don't. So lead us now down to 34. Again, he answers, we couldn't, lead down to 24. Again, he answers, we couldn't, lead down to 14. Again, he answers, we don't, lead down to 4. And the next slide, the end. We're
but they didn't tell you even on the last question that it was the last
question. I don't think they said, because I remember sighing a huge sigh of relief when that slide came up. If there was one more question, he definitely would have won.
I think this is a good way to commercialize quizzing, not to tell the number of questions.
Yeah. But it should end like this only, then they'll have value in
it.
Also, have you seen quizzes asking how many questions are left, score check after this question? It's not possible.
So I mean, it's not possible. So for a layman, I'm sure unless they come and take part, they won't be able to understand the dynamics, the excitement, the kind of analysis that goes into. I mean, it's probably more analytical than a football game or a cricket match. I mean, the kind of stuff that people do to ensure that the strategy is perfect. So, I mean, you have to be a quizzer, be there, go through quizzes, experience this. It's not possible to put this forward to a layman who has not quizzed at all.
This reminds me of my second Crucible win. So we were leading by, so it was the time when you could select your own score for an answer. From 2 to 6 or something like that. We were leading only by 3 points, and it was the last question. So Siddharth, who was my partner then in my final year, he said the answer, which was the correct answer, which was Mayfair. Basically, it's a very famous hotel in Bhubaneswar also. So the London Funda and things like that. But I said, Rukja. Unko nahi pata. I was like, haan, sahi hai tera, lekin hum nahi le sakte. And I kept looking at them, and they had no clue. And they buzzed, and they of course got it wrong. And I was like, ki aise bhi khelna padta hai. Or buzzer quizzes, which is why there's a slightly different dynamic that goes along. as in you're focusing on one team, just as in because the setting is such, right, in that you can see all the other teams, unlike in a probably a Fountain Box where everybody is looking towards the stage. So there's that extra zing that comes in.
100%, fully agreed. This also reminds me the number of times where we've looked at a team that was very close to us in terms of points. Inko nahi pata hai, so let's wait. And then what happens? So they are smarter.
Yeah, same.
Now we have also picked up that thing. So behave as if you don't know the answer. Maintain a straight face. Behave as if you don't know the answer. Let them not pause, and then we will answer on the pause.
I was going to say this used to work till 3 years back. Now it does not work at all.
No, it still works. It still has worked very well for us in this even the very last live quiz that I could attend, the KQA open in March. So it worked even then. We maintained straight face and ensured the team next to us did not bounce.
So I have the tendency of, even if we know the answer, I'm like, discuss karte raho taki unko lage ki abhi bhi sure nahi answer.
Exactly.
Yeah, and even the opposite way, that you don't know the answer, but you act like you do, so probably they can take a negative form if it's a tough question. It's very, as in it's done on a lower quantity than the other one.
If you can remind me after this episode, so there's something called a lion theory in Kerala. So ages ago, some 15-20 years ago, one of my very good friends, Dr. Sarin, qualified civil services, and now he's quit. He's a doctor, so he's quit medicine and civil service, and he's now working for the International Congress in Kerala. So he was excellent quizzer. So he used to do this, maintain a straight face. And the first time he did this was for a quiz where something like a lion was the answer, or it was a lion's quiz, as in conducted by the Lions Club. So in Kerala, the slang for this is lion theory, maintaining a straight face, discussed to give the impression that you don't know the answer. So there's a lion theory, and there's a reverse lion theory as well, just the opposite of it. So people who know that this is happening, so just to counter that, you actually pounce even if they are maintained. So there's a lion theory, there's a reverse lion theory. So we have a proper dictionary of Kerala quizzing where all this is maintained. So if you can remind me, I'll share that link with you. Go through it. Hilarious, some 500 odd entries with regards to slang terms and quizzing in Kerala. Along the lines of the AJM document on Ottawa. Just remind me, I'll send it to you.
Yes, right. So Major, we recently saw a tweet of yours where you talked about a favorite right answer from a quiz you conducted. But has there ever been any instance of where some team answers a question and you love the thought process behind it, but it's sadly a wrong answer?
So in fact, if you attended quizzes that I've done, almost always, at least 3 or 4 times I tell this during a quiz, oh, this is the wrong answer, but it's such a beautiful answer. It deserves to be compiled into a quiz, into a book with only wrong answers. So I've mentioned this so many times. So the thing is I always try and make it a point to remember this and try and note it down, but I almost always forget to do that. I was sitting and I try to recollect such instances a lot. The only thing that immediately comes to mind is a question that I asked a couple of years back at the Illuminati quiz. Can I actually share my screen? Show you the question and then explain how it is like. Do you want me to read out the question?
Yeah.
So Dash Dash is a non-profit organization founded in 1990 in Baltimore, Maryland, and provides food and services to people suffering from HIV, breast cancer, and terminal illness cases. In their first year, they catered to 60 individuals, and this number went up to 550 by 2001. The organization and its volunteers have been commended by a mainstream media and donors for their efforts to deliver rich meals to the sick and the poor who had difficulty leaving their residences. What is the name of this entity best known to us through another 1960s context? Now there is a helpful pick. Take a guess as to what your answer would be, and then I will explain what the wrong answer to this question was, and then give you the correct answer if you're not able to get it. Look at the length of the blanks, blank size indicator. Look at what this guy is doing here. You're talking of rich meals.
Is this something to do with Atlas Shrugged and Ayn Rand?
Not Atlas Shrugged.
I actually saw the answer, so I'm keeping quiet.
Okay. But yeah, try give me a wrong answer then if you've seen the answer.
This is the first time I've had this request.
Let's see if you can get to that wrong answer that I got. It's a beautiful wrong answer. It actually fits in, it takes a lot of columns with regards to what this question is all about. It fits the image beautifully. What is he doing there? He is
catering.
Or a simple word?
So
a term you would find in the context of food as well. Food with everything in the right quantities. Something you would have come across in your school days, in your science textbooks.
Balanced meal?
Balanced diet is what I got as the answer to this question. So it fits beautifully there because you're talking of rich meals, delivering it to the sick and the poor. The sick and the poor need balanced diet. And you look at the fact that he's actually balancing the diet on his hands. But the actual answer happened to be Movable Feast, which is Ernest Hemingway's work, released posthumously. So this actually balanced diet fits in beautifully as an answer here. It fits in, it ticks almost everything here. It could have been a potential right answer. But this is one of those examples where I thought people analyzed the question well, took in the hints I wanted them to note, analyzed the image correctly, and then got to the right wrong answer. So this is one thing that has been very, very memorable. And I think there's one more question like this from that same quiz. Let me see if it's that. Yeah. Philip Astley was an Englishman who lived in the 18th century. His dream was to work with horses, so he joined the 15th Light Dragoons, and his service brought him into contact with professional trainers and riders. He had a genius for trick riding and opened a riding school in London where he could conduct shows of riding skills. He also added other novelty performances to this place in an effort to attract more audiences. The manner in which he rode at his establishment was different from that of his rivals, so that his horses did not have to stop. And this resulted in a convention still followed by such places. What convention is this? You're talking of certain places. He added novelty performances.
Oh,
horses okay. Mentioned.
I have a guess. So these are the doors, movable doors in bars.
Nice guess, but no. Think of a kind of location, a context where you would find multiple novelty performances. You would, of course, find horses.
Purpose.
And horses did not have to stop.
So, would they change riders while in motion? So, that's how valet parking came about.
Very nice, but no.
I was thinking circuses and some trapeze. Something to do with no, I don't think.
Horses did not have to stop.
So
if anything is moving, how can you ensure that it would not stop? What kind of a motion would ensure this?
Conveyor belt type. Okay. Continuing. So
there is
a straight line path.
Slightly modify that.
Okay. Did we help me here?
I'm thinking.
Think of what you said initially. You gave me a context.
What did you say? I forgot.
Conveyor belt?
Huh? Not conveyor belt. Think of your very first answer. The very first answer.
The door
thing. No, after that.
What did I say? A circus.
Okay.
Okay. Circus mein kya hota hai, sir? Okay, let me just...
What convention is followed by circuses? Basic convention. If you've been to a circus, how do circus performances happen? What kind of a venue, arena is it?
It's a tent.
Okay. What is inside the tent? How is the layout?
The audiences are sloped towards the center circular.
Circular. So this is why circuses are circular.
Oh, no. Okay.
Because he would ride his horses in a circle so that they did not have to stop. And this is why circuses are circular in shape. Now, this is the right answer. But the answer that I got that day was a carousel. A carousel again has horses. So people have to sit on the horse, the inanimate horse, and ride the carousel. And again, carousels, if you don't switch it off, they won't stop. So again, it fits in beautifully as an answer. It's just that it is not the correct answer. So these are a couple of examples where I thought people analyzed the question beautifully, noted the clues that I wanted them to note, and got to an answer, which unfortunately was wrong. So you could call them the correct wrong answer. So a couple of examples that I could immediately remember.